Welcome back. You're still watching Urban Today, and we've got something for you. It's about UInnovate. Uganda's innovations have improved over the years. More innovations are still coming up, and many young innovators still have limited knowledge and guidance on how to make their innovations applicable. This is The Gap. I want David Oyet, a student at Clark International University, aims at bridging to encourage more innovations and their applicability. Now, we caught up with David Oyet, and this is the report.
Back in the day, Uganda had hundreds of innovations birthed by young brains, but most of them would end at inception. None was applied in daily life. Today, however, the story is different. Over the years, innovation in Uganda has improved. Young brains have developed innovations which are used to better day-to-day lives of the users. This has seen Uganda ranked by the Martin Prosperity Institute of the United States as the second best country with advanced technological and innovation capabilities in Africa after South Africa. To improve further, I want David Oyet, a student at Clark International University, has come up with a leader's innovation camp dubbed UInnovate Club to guide and mastermind new ideas.
We came up with an innovation club. So we looked at the different clubs that students have at universities, and we thought we should have a club that basically deals with brainstorming and masterminding on ideas. So hoping that they can use the classroom knowledge and transform it into real tangible product or solution that can help in changing society or developing society.
The UInnovate Club also focuses on having students accustomed to the research culture and be able to practically apply what is learnt in the classroom to create innovations that can solve problems in the society.
Ugandan youth at the university and even outside of the university need to concentrate on viewing society's challenges, whether it's queuing up in the hospital for too long or not getting the drugs that you need when you go to pharmacies. We need to start looking at those as opportunities to create solutions, opportunities for us to thrive, make something of ourselves that leaves the society a better place. So as long as these problems remain with us, students should understand that they are a part of that, they can be a part of that solution.
UInnovate tells people to borrow knowledge that they study and transform it to what they will earn tomorrow.
The club uses three principles to achieve its goal.
We use three principles. The first principle is the logic die. The logic die is to help students to manage their thinking process. And then we use the mastermind principle to help them bring more brains together to kind of bit and shape that idea. Of course, the third one is research. We don't look at the complex research, but we look at the basic research, as simple as asking about something they don't know.
David Oyet, the brain behind UInnovate, says he was inspired by the innovation clubs in India and Malaysia, thus resolving to start up a similar club in Uganda. The participants expect to learn a lot and also start up innovations of their own.
So basically it's to learn so that I can be able to depend on me even after university or even while I'm still in university, because innovation doesn't necessarily mean that you must do it after university. You can also still do it when you're still in university.
I hope to achieve more of innovating, setting up something of my own, not always relying on what we study as notes and what, but being creative. That is why I'm here.
The student leaders we talk to are medical students who believe that innovations have greatly improved the medical field.
In the medical field, we do need innovation. For instance, gone are the days when people used to walk to hospitals to go for a malaria checkup, to go for a pregnancy checkup, or to even go for an HIV checkup. Nowadays, with innovation, people use strips.
The participants are grateful for what they have learned so far regarding innovation in Uganda.
Generally, just explored what innovation looks like, what opportunities are they are on the local scale, but also on the global scale, and just how they can go about it, how do they start to create these spaces, but also the why for innovation. We explored the fact that as long as problems remain in our society, it means that there still remains room for innovation.
First and foremost, I've gone to learn about the different innovative hubs, design hub. I had never heard of it. Nita Uganda. I've learned that with my ideas, I know the right people I can run to, or if my other colleagues have ideas, I can actually direct them to the right people they can go to and air out their ideas.
The Leaders Innovation Camp is expected to become an annual event that will also celebrate ideas birthed throughout the year.
This is the first. We're introducing this idea to the student leaders and hoping that from next year we'll start running this annually. So next year we'll be looking at celebrating what they've done.
The young people have called upon government to support young innovators.
The willingness for them to support these solutions to come from laboratory to market. So with policy, enabling environment policies and actual investment in these innovations. So if you say that these Ugandan youth and innovations are brilliant, let's put money where our mouth is.
Well, quite interesting. You innovate there. There are very many clubs in schools. Interact Club, Scouts Club. Which other club was there during your years? Debate Club.
Debate Club, Writers Club.
Writers Club. Mm. But we missed out on the Innovations Club. Mm. Probably those days, our days. But we are not so old.
Being innovative was not something that it wasn't really, thing applauded
those days,
that much.
Yes. You know? But the fact that now it's a trend, I mean, we have an Innovations Club. And I'm thinking it's a good development because it helps young innovators who have come up with ideas to bring their ideas to reality.
That's true. And it's I like the fact that, you know, they are taking an initiative upon themselves as the youth to make sure that they begin with their ideas and develop their ideas. Mm-hmm. And the positivity that they're all having, it's an interesting one.
It's interesting.
I liked what Yvonne did mention right there. She was very vocal. So I feel like it's something that we can take on.
Yes, caution copyright law. Because I'll come up with an idea, my young innovator, I don't have money. Then Derek will just, okay, not Derek.
Because when you talk money, Derek, good. There's not Derek who's broke.
Okay, then Derek with his money comes, jumps on my idea, takes it, and starts minting even more money out of it. Yet I, who developed the idea, I'm here dying in what? In poverty.
In
so that's the caution. Copyright law, put it in consideration. But it's a good idea, David Oyet.
All right, then. There you have it. Now we're going for another short break. But when we do get back, our guest seems to have made it to studio. It was a little bit held up by traffic, being a rainy morning. But we'll have a lot to talk about. Just keep it right here. It happened today.
You're still watching Urban Today. Welcome back from that short break. Time for pick of the day, and we are speaking violence against children. We've talked about violence in many ways, sexual violence. We've talked about emotional violence. We've talked about physical violence against children. One in three girls and boys experience some form of violence by a parent or adult caregiver. And the most common perpetrator of emotional violence is a child's mother or stepmother. All details about violence. And today, I have the Kampala Metropolitan Police spokesperson, Luke Owoyesigire. He's going to be telling us more about violence and how it's handled by the police. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Good to have you here.
Good to be here too.
Yes, we've talked about violence and the causes. And one of the questions that has always popped up is whether the regulations are satisfying, or the laws to fight violence are satisfying.
Yes.
Another challenge has come up is implementation of this law. First and foremost, as the police or the Kampala Metropolitan Police spokesperson, do you think the laws to fight violence are satisfying?
Well, I can ably tell you that they are indeed satisfying. But of course, as you know, laws, these are laws that were probably put up some time back. And I believe a change in them also might not be bad, for the good, of course, not for the bad. We've had, of course, challenges, and we have an issue in this law whereby you have to hold someone has been reported at the police station for 48 hours. And then you have to produce that someone to courts of law after 48 hours. And we've had a challenge in especially sexual violence, whereby there is a lot to prove. And most of these things that you're supposed to prove are scientific. And we've had challenges with our laboratories. Sometimes getting evidence from there is a bit slow. And we cannot keep up with this 48-hour rule, especially in a case of sexual violence where a child has been defiled, where a child has been raped. And that's most cases where we come in the light, probably for holding someone for so long. And sometimes even the parents of these children have reported to us, feel like maybe we have been probably we are siding maybe with a gentleman and we are refusing to take him to courts of law or something. But that is not the case. It is always important to take someone to courts of law when you're sure this person is going to be convicted and you're sure you have enough evidence to convict this person.
So how do you deal with such cases? There's not enough time, but you need to produce this person before the courts of law. You don't want to take them when you're not sure he's going to be convicted. And then also the people or the victim or the victim's parents are also thinking you're siding with the police. Then how do you handle that?
We have always advised the parents when they report, let us do investigations before arrest.
Okay.
Get enough evidence that this happened, then the gentleman can be called upon at a later time when you have enough evidence to maybe write his statement and maybe samples picked from him, which would be tested and maybe related to the ones you already have from the child, and from there you can always take to the courts of law. But we have impatient Ugandans. Whenever they come to you and report to you a case that this has happened, they want you to go right away and make an arrest, which will come back and bite you later. Of course, it is the proper thing to do because that is a very, very big crime. All crimes are big, but this one, the magnitude, we believe, is very big. So it is always, because these are people who come to us crying, lamenting this and this, and when you take long to do what they feel is right for them, they can always, you know, allege anything. So we have always advised them, we have always talked to parents, let us do investigations before we make an arrest, so that by the time we make an arrest, we don't infringe on anyone's rights. But of course, with time, maybe it will catch up. But in such cases, I believe maybe they should be, like the way you've said, are the laws working enough? Maybe that there should be an adjustment in such cases whereby we can hold some of those people for quite maybe some time until we are done with our investigation.
Okay, so are there any efforts to have this implemented?
Yes, of course. Our management and our lawyers have always written to Parliament, and also civil society. In most cases, we cannot handle such cases alone, especially like now educating the public.
Exactly.
We cannot do that alone. So, in conjunction with civil society, we have made drafts and they've been presented to Parliament.
Yeah, because I'm thinking the public needs more of this information. We need to know that, okay, when police says that, or first of all, when I take my case to police, what is the first thing that happens?
Yes.
So we need this information out there to the public. What is the most, what's the cause of the most common violence against children, which is sexual violence, like you said?
Yes, the cause, I might not necessarily tell you the cause, because we believe...
According to the cases that you've registered.
I will not say maybe the man has a problem with the head. Okay. That's why he had to probably sexually assault this lady or a boy. It is just general. Things, people just do bad things.
Mm.
Not because they are not upright in the head, but they just do bad things because they feel it is right.
Mm.
And of course, sometimes they give reasons like, I was told by maybe a witch doctor to do that, all those things. Just, it's sort of like child sacrifice in a way. Might not murder the child, but of course, probably someone has told you, do this with a child and maybe you'll be rich. All those reasons have come up, but me... we have always blamed the person, and if we exempt you for a medical checkup, because you can imagine an uncle and a niece, it is something that is really out of this world, but it is happening. We knew, apparently this lady who murdered the child, that is also violence, by the way, against children. You don't expect a mother to go and kill
their own child.
Their own child, but it is happening.
Mm.
So we believe you should blame the person a lot. Maybe social, maybe sometimes these things are social, economic, or who knows.
Okay.
But as long as the crime has happened, it is up to us, the police, to make sure that it is investigated and that such people are brought to book.
Mm. So as the police, what have you done or what are you doing to protect children? What are you doing for child protection?
We have opened up, this office has been there for quite some long time, Child and Family Protection Unit. It, in relation with dealing with family issues, maybe giving advice to parents who have neglected their children in a way. We also investigate and give advice to children,
okay,
or pupils in their schools, make sure that they find it easier to come out to us and inform us. If the crime is too big, like maybe a rape, we take it up further to a unit that investigates such cases, and we have taken people to court. But this unit is probably is there to make sure that confidence is there in the public, so that they can always approach the police in cases whereby parents have failed to fulfill the fundamental rights of their children. Children can always come to us. Daddy doesn't pay fees for me, mommy doesn't do this for me. Children can always come to us. Through all people, they can always go through their headmistresses, headmasters, and if she's being punished day in, day out, they can always communicate through their relevant teachers, and the teachers can always come to us, and such cases are always investigated. We've taken people to courts of law because of giving of not taking care of the children, and also these assault cases whereby children are beaten up. And it is, of course, against the law to give us, of course, there's where you're supposed to stop when you're punishing your child.
Okay.
But you don't have to reach an extent of assaulting your child, burning the hands, beating up the child to the point of death. These things are happening. I've recently in Chireka, I think like one and a half weeks ago, there's a father who beat up a child and so burnt because the child stole something like 200 shillings.
Very sad story there.
Very sad.
So if because this is physical violence.
Yes, physical violence.
So if I am to discipline my child, because for us we grew up in ages where we were beaten, not beaten to the point of death, we were beaten.
Yes.
So where do I draw the line? How should I discipline my child so that I'm not to be taken as a criminal?
Well, I remember when we were young, they used to, I don't know who brought that thing that a child is supposed to be caned with the buttocks.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know the scientific issue behind it.
Probably because maybe there's too much flesh.
But as far as I know, when you hit someone in any place, less than a buttocks or maybe a back, there are some important organs that are there that might bring a problem to this child. The ribs, of course, might cause a problem to maybe the lungs when that bone breaks. You might cause any problem, maybe on the head, maybe you will cause a problem to the eye. And now when you reach an extent of burning the hands so that this child does not steal again or pick your money. You know, some people don't call it stealing, picking.
Picking the money. Sometimes it's even home soup.
Home soup or something. Soup. They don't call it stealing. Now when the child steals from the parents, they say he has picked. Or he has picked. So I believe there is that human nature whereby you know that when I beat my child on the buttocks, this is okay, he will have learned a lesson, or maybe I can tell this child that you're not going to have breakfast today, or maybe if
I'm being given torture them psychologically, because there's also psychological and emotional violence.
There are always ways of punishing a child, but not necessarily causing physical harm on them.
Okay.
And the psychological part, you just have to love your child anyway. Because I don't think you can starve your child forever. Or you can starve your child when you want. It depends. I'm not here to educate parents on how to discipline their children necessarily. By the way,
we just want to draw the line from being a criminal.
Yes.
And disciplining, because if I beat them and I'm told when you just beat them it is violence, it's punishable by law, but then if I'm beating them on the buttocks and they come and they report me, then are you going to come and arrest me because I'm a criminal?
Of course they have to be like you don't have to beat your child to an extent that even marks can be seen, because when you go to the doctor, the doctor will That has to
evidence.
Be proved scientifically. The doctor will have to say that this child was harmed.
So we have to go with beating.
I don't know.
Okay.
Some people find beating okay. Some people don't find it okay. So it always depends. All I can tell you, as long as you don't bring physical harm
to your child,
you can always find other measures. Maybe if she was supposed to go for holiday, you can say, no, you're not going to go for holiday. You know, all the tactics, parents know these things, I believe.
Okay, so for the time the police has been fighting violence or getting criminals and also other organizations coming up, other organizations to fight violence against children, do we see a trend of cases reducing? Are they on the increase?
Actually, they are on the increase. Not necessarily because now it is happening a lot. But we are trying as much as possible to see that we educate the public that this is wrong, this is bad. NGOs have come in, police has come in, and all the concerned government ministries have come in to educate the public about what is supposed to be done when something like this happens to a child. Long ago, whenever a child of like 15 would get pregnant, they would tell her she was raped by someone, but they would tell her get married to that person. They would not come and report that to the police. But now, people come. People would always sort their issues outside the police. Give me some money. I will not take
report
this issue
you.
Anywhere.
Mm.
They handle such issues. You assault a child and your neighbor doesn't mind. Nowadays, neighbors mind. So we should look it in the way that are those cases that are being reported to us, successful have they been? How have we handled them? How many people have we convicted?
So what are some of those statistics? Have you...
Yes.
Okay. What are some of the statistics?
I might not be able to capitalize on the specific statistics that have happened, but I can able to tell you that we have handled those cases very good. We have convicted people.
You have success stories?
We have success stories in that.
Okay.
But it is always important not to come to police. There is reporting to police early and reporting to police late.
Mm.
And most parents are still doing that. After failing to sort your issue with the other person because you wanted something from him or her, then they start saying, let me go to police.
Mm.
So it also becomes bad for the child, especially when she has been sexually assaulted in a way. So it becomes
bad. You need to report early.
To report early. Yes, people are coming in more and more. But also coming in early can also save this child child's life, because some of these sexual predators have been found sick in a way, and
the situation would have been saved if they were treated early.
So parents out there, you should always come early, especially in such cases. I believe maybe the audience we are dealing with right now is doing that, but people in villages down there, maybe in Chiriandongo, here in Wakiso, in the villages, some of them are not doing that. Some of them are still, you know.
Okay, so how are you planning to get them on track?
We are trying very much, of course. Like I told you, we are working very hard with NGOs. We have partnered up with a lot of them. And we go and spread the message.
Mm.
We go and teach the public what they're supposed to do.
Okay, there's an issue that is normally among the public. We got this person, let's say sexual assault, because it's the highest. There's this victim, I don't want to call them criminal, not a victim, the criminal, the one who, the suspected rapist. Mm. So this rapist, we come to police, report the case. The suspected rapist is put in the bars, behind bars. Then the following day or 2 days after, he's walking on the streets. But this criminal just allegedly raped a kid on the village.
Yes.
We are thinking, okay, why did police release this person when we don't even know we who are affected?
Yes, it is very unfortunate. Actually, the officers in charge of investigating such cases are supposed to give reasons.
Okay.
Why this person has been released and on which conditions. Is he connected to the issue, or in any way, bond is a constitutional right. But
yes,
you're supposed, before you give bond to someone, you're supposed to talk to the complainants. It is a very civil thing to do.
Mm.
Explain to them why you're giving this bond to this person. Or sometimes, you know, we've had cases whereby, very unfortunate by the way, whereby parents coach their kids to say, this person, can't say this person did what?
Raped me.
So whenever we get that evidence, and sometimes the woman is arrested, now they will start saying, you know, the public might start saying, now we are siding with the suspected criminal, and we are now arresting the complainant, yet in most cases she had given us false information, and we have gotten to know that. And something ought to be done about that, because it is also, you have broken the law also. So in that aspect, you can, a good community liaison officer is supposed to go to the public and explain to them.
And explain to them
this
why.
This is what has happened.
Okay.
Give us time. You know, everything needs time. And they also, the public also needs answers. So give the answers to the public as you go back your duties.
All right, your final message to the viewers out there?
My final message is, keep on reporting to us. These issues are not, it's not like they're not happening. They're happening. Children are being sexually assaulted every day. They're being tortured. And don't just keep quiet because a mother or father is beating up the child every day, every night, and you just keep quiet. You hear a child crying every day, every night, and you just keep quiet. There are numbers that have been provided by the ministries, taking them up, and always inform police in time so that we can always intervene in time. Children have died because they have been beaten day in, day out. Children now, like when you hear this case of the recent case whereby a mother killed
their own child,
people are hearing noises in the house, but they could not mind. Says these are parents, these are their children, they cannot do anything. So later on they have to realize that something bad had happened. So it is very important to always call the police in time. We are there, we shall always receive you. We are rolling out our contacts at the police posts, at the police stations, at the divisions. Call us all the time and we can always come to you and make sure that we work on your situation and we get rid of all the crime in our societies.
All right. Many thanks, Luke Oyesugire, the Kampala Metropolitan Police spokesperson. At this point, we'll take a short break and return with the latest in the world of sport and also take a look at what's trending on the timeline. Stay tuned to Urban TV.
All right, thank you very much for keeping it right here with us on Urban Today. Getting into some sports for you on sport this morning. Nicholas is here in studio to give me more of the latest of what has been happening both locally and internationally. Bonjour.
Bonjour, monsieur. Mwaka gugwawa. Savabia mwaka gugwawa.
Mwaka gugenda.
Nye gugenda. Echilevu chichichi. Nga chikuze nyo.
Echilevu leka nisoke nchikuze ma. Atitu ingida November. November wajimanyi.
Nechide mwavi kusayi.
But it's a no shave.
Jowa don nyiganti o indio inao nito inao.
Aneo tu ugenda muno shave November. Prostate cancer awareness. Toka manya ako.
Hey, mbeda ambi. Anyway, have you been?
Sini mubi.
There's a question actually for all our viewers about rather if you want to win yourself a shirt. That's of course a dance off. Yeah. The question is who won the Formula One Championship this season? If you answer that question correctly on our Facebook page at Urban TV, you could win yourself a very nice, well-designed dance off. No boss. Okay. No sir.
All right. So
sport this morning.
I hope Amina will have that question.
Yes, that question, of course. I repeat the question. Who won the Formula One Championship this season, 2018?
You get yourself
a t-shirt. Or winner, heavy engines.
Formula One,
Simple question.
Let's begin with local sport, looking at the UPL match day 5. Yesterday, some results did come through. Seville, of course, coming out to end 0-0 with URA. I think that was one of the biggest games that were anticipating to have a win.
Well, another winless, outing for the Jogos. The fans yesterday came out in decent numbers only to watch their side fail to find the back of the net in a goalless draw against the tax collectors, who are, by the way, still unbeaten in the UPL under Sam Simbo. Of course, Moses Basson, so many questions have been asked of him whether he's the rightful man for this job. But that game over there was the most entertaining, a red card and 4 goals on match day at the mighty arena between the defending champions in Vipers in blue up against Charles Ayoko's Chargers in red. A game that I thought Vipers should have won, but somehow threw away their 2-1 lead after Daniel Muzei Serunkuma did put them in front. A man in Joel Madondo was a nightmare for that is Vipers. He came from behind twice to secure a valuable point for the Ginger Best Club side in Kirinya Ginger Essence. For the second time, by the way, Vipers failing to get something or rather all 3 points from Jinja against Kirinya. Of course, 2 seasons back, they were stunned by that same side, and that is Joel Madondo getting a big hug from his boss in Charles Eko, who of course called out for the boys to rise to the occasion. That is Daniel Serunkuma's spot kick, barring it, no mistake for the man there in Daniel Serunkuma, who at that point scored the second goal. And just when you thought Vipers would actually make it 5 in a row, Kirinya had other ideas, and Joel Madondo securing a point for Kirinya. One Mohamed Madidi was sent off for an early shot. He was a naughty boy. He was sent off for a very bad foul on Noah Wafura, who also got on the score sheet for Vipers Sports Club. A point secured, and Vipers, their winning streak coming to an end. They're still unbeaten, but points dropped on match day against Kirinya. Looking elsewhere in Luzira, Maroons FC succumbed to another defeat. More worry lines, more misery for George Best in Simbe, as he lost out to Ginger Best Club side in Bull FC over Peter Onen. Question marks around the man in George Besson Simbe since arriving in the job at Maroons FC. No win as of now for the Prison Club side in Maroons. Of course, goals coming in there from Haman Waswa for the home side in Maroons. Ojok and Hamis Tibita coming out to score for Bull FC. And there will be more action lined up today. We do have a reunion as well. I talk about reunion then of one Paul Mutuarezi will be returning to his former side in Kese FC with the Ankole Lions coming to contention to face Kampala Capital City Authority Football Club side, who will be out to secure yet another win in the bag, three in a bounce if they do get all 3 points against Mbara City of Charles, rather of Livingstone in Mbabazi. But in Wankulukuku, one Waswa boss will also be going back to a club that used to be on his heart, or rather it wasn't still on his heart, but wait and see. He'll also be facing Express FC when Toro United do come into contention against Red Eagles Mukwano Gwamanyi. Hopefully the rains won't come down, because yesterday so much rain came down, and Police FC matches they won the game
matches that,
against Nyamitobora. Yes, the rains didn't affect the game, or actually it did affect the game, but not, you know, calling the game off. Oh, but yeah, the rains will be a worry today going into the game, because the Wankuluku Stadium is not the best of stadiums. Whenever the rains come down, it tends to have a soaky turf, and that, of course, affects the players one way or the other. But yeah, that's the game lined up. Express up against Toro United, and the other tie does have KCFC up against the team in, that is, of course, Mbara City.
I mean, having this kind of results, I must say, this season for the UPL could seem a very unpredictable one, looking at the fact that SC Villa has not yet won itself any game.
Well,
Vipers still being unbeaten despite losing.
I tell you what,
there's right
still
there.
So much that needs to be done or worked upon. I mean, yesterday we saw some promising performances from the Joggers, but you can only wait and see how they fare in the next games. Same with you, they are wasteful on the day. They have a couple of good signings in there. Serumaga as well, wasteful on the day. Like I said, it wasn't their best of outings, but you want to think it will be it's work in progress, especially now that you have my manager like Moses Basina, who's been around for quite some time, a very experienced man, but they need results. And that's the fans coming out to call for the immediate sacking of Moses Basina.
All right, let's cross over to some EFL. Yesterday, that we did have a game, Bournemouth managing to make it to the quarterfinals.
Well, Cup football came through yesterday. Of course, the English Football League Cup starting off with the fourth round. Bournemouth of Eddie Howe getting the result they needed, advancing into the quarterfinals for the second year running last season. They also found themselves in this very position. Two goals yesterday, enough to go past the championship side in Norwich City. And Iwane Junior Mark Stanislas getting the opener inside 39 minutes. And just when you thought Hernandez's equalizer would force extra time, Steve Cork had other ideas. The second goal to restore Bournemouth's lead as it ended 2-1. Bournemouth into the quarterfinals, a result that, of course, does get the Cherries back to winning ways. They haven't done so well in the domestic league, that is in Bournemouth, and it was always important to get a result, especially for cup football. It's always full of surprises. Yesterday, we didn't see that surprise coming, with Norwich City failing to go past Bournemouth, or rather into the quarterfinals for the fourth year running. And for Bournemouth, you can only say thumbs up for them. Elsewhere, Barton aging Nottingham Forest, three goals to two, an own goal from Janko inside 52 minutes. Fraser and Hesketh scoring the other two for Barton, who also advanced into the quarterfinals. Of course, for Nottingham Forest, failing to replicate what they had last season, crushing out Arsenal. Goals coming in from Graban and Appiah scoring late on. It was nothing but a consolation for the side in Nottingham Forest. Leicester and Southampton was called up, because we know the sad news that unfolded over the weekend.
They're
still in grief, and this game has been pushed to a further date that is yet to be
communicated.
Not yet.
All right, let's wait and see how that gets to unfold. Now, still talking about EFL, we do have a big game that we're all anticipating too. That is Arsenal up against Blackpool.
Arsenal Blackpool tonight. Of course, we expect the manager in Unai Emery to make a few changes. It's a tournament that doesn't, you know, seem to catch the eye of many managers. Arsene Wenger never won this competition. The closest it came to was, I think, 8 years back when he lost to Birmingham City. But yeah, Unai Emery said to make a few changes in his starting 11 as far as this game gets to go. Emil Rose Smith was being aggressive.
Probable lineup?
Yeah, I do have actually one there. We talk about Peter Cech returning standing in goal for Arsenal ahead of Ben Leno. We talk about Linstein at right back now that Hector Bellerin is out injured. Centre back, and Zakaria Medley, one who is very, very exciting to watch as far as he gets to go. He's also played in the under 23, was on the bench against Leicester City. Should be pairing with Sokratis. And as for Sokratis, of course, formerly at Borussia Dortmund, should give him the support that he needs going into this game. Left back, we should be looking at Maitland-Niles, having recovered from that dead leg. Of course, he's been out. We know he can play in that position. A very versatile player in Maitland-Niles. The left backs in Nacho and Siad Kolasinac should be out, bearing in mind that there is a big game coming up this weekend for Arsenal. So for Unai Emery, it's only understandable that he gets to rest his senior players ahead of this game tonight against Blackpool. Guendouzi, Ross Smith, like I mentioned, Mkhitaryan on the right, Welbeck on the left. I should be able to start or to pack that midfield along with Aaron Ramsey to support from to provide cover to players in Guendouzi. Up front for me should be Eddie Nketiah. He was impressive last season. He's been quite the player this season. Hopefully tonight he can impress the boss in Unai Emery going into tonight's game. And looking at the other fixtures, by the way, we do have a one Frank Lampard set to return to the bridge, where he did tremendously well during his spell.
Another win for
Well, he crushed out United, so tonight could be another shocker for the Blues if they don't take him so seriously. And I think they will take him seriously, because then the last time Derby County played in this competition, they beat up on United in the penalty shootout. And for Frank Lampard, it will be a special night for the former Chelsea player. So many memories at that stadium in London, and tonight would be so much beautiful for the former England international if you got a result against his former side in Chelsea of Maurizio's side. West Ham up against Tottenham Hotspurs in Southeast London. Middlesbrough up against Crystal Palace, of course, who drew over the weekend against Arsenal.
It's going to be an interesting night.
It should be.
All right, now that brings us to the end of Sport This Morning. We're definitely going to go in for a very quick short break, but when we do get back, we'll have Hashtag and talking about the timeline. Getting to have Aben today on the timeline, we definitely begin it off with the big question for today that we did ask you to be part of on our Facebook page. Now, hashtag Aben today, FBI did honor the Uganda police officers as far as fighting terrorism is concerned. Now, we did ask you to get, of course, what do you think about the FBI's praise for the Uganda's police? And now, responses coming in right here. Don Mukala says, how could this FBI people be bewitched to the extent of honoring the fakest and corrupt police in the entire universe? Okay, that is his personal response. Godfrey Kodmale says, Uganda police is a body that is rotten, but there are some individual officers who are hardworking, loyal, and of course trustworthy. That is, of course, his also opinion. Ugandan Dobozi Ugaba. Okay, interesting Facebook name there. Says, justice must be done. Hassan says, about Basiru. Okay. Ray C. Uganda says, watch Urban TV on free air decoders. Okay. I did not understand that one. But anyway, thank you very much for those of you who have been part of this conversation. Willis Daly, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
Very, very interesting morning. First of all, before you get into the interesting part, I'd like to say that if you have something that you'd like to give to Bududa victims, people who've been affected by the landslides, Urban TV is partnering with a couple of young people to, you know, to collect utensils, cups, plates, spoons, whatever, socks, whatever you feel you can give, whether you like it or not, or you feel like you can. Yeah, there are some things you have in your house, but you don't like them. So you can just bring them, whether it's an empty bottle or plastic bottle or cup, whatever you can get. We're just collecting as much things as possible with these guys, and then going and, you know, finding someone could pick something that you thought was not important and they could use it. So just, you know.
But much as someone would pick something that you think is not important, also please don't will it sound good?
No, just be honest about it.
Just drop it.
Sometimes I also say, okay, did I say it? Please don't bring something that you are going to throw in the dust.
Kasasiro.
Don't bring Kasasiro. That was garbage, but
yeah, bring something that can actually be
something that, okay, yeah, you may not be using it, but someone else can use it. Not something rotten, like something to the point of being a rag, and you're going to give it to someone. So, yes, let's give, but.
There's a couple, I think a number of shirts I have at home that I rarely, rarely wear. They're too big for me. Like a friend
of mine. But you can actually give them.
Yeah, they get them to me from abroad. You know those things when your aunt is coming and then they bring you. Yeah, so one of my friends.
So your other summer have already checked in.
Yeah, exactly. So they brought me the shirts.
When are yours coming?
Me, we don't have any.
Anyway, now what's happening on the timeline? Someone came to Denzel. He had to tweet this because it was really personal for him. He said, Denzel. So, did you sell your small car? Because I saw you in a border border yesterday. And then he's complaining about people's mindsets and saying some mindsets are sad. Just because you see a person on a border border doesn't mean they don't own a car. Yes, if I see you on a border border at that moment, you don't own a car.
Yeah, sometimes it's fuel issues.
Not even fuel, traffic.
End of the month.
Traffic.
Yeah, traffic.
Sometimes I'm trying to avoid traffic and I want to get to a place very quickly.
If you have a car in this weather and you opt for a border border.
Okay, there's an issue. But now you see. End of the month.
No. Okay, it's raining, there are many reasons. Traffic is
there are many reasons, but
so
one of the
jump
most
on a
important
bike
reasons.
Yes.
You have to get somewhere real quick.
One of the biggest reasons you can't avoid if it happened to you is if your car got clamped.
Okay,
if your car is clamped,
then if I had a deal,
jump on a border, whether you like it or not.
Well, if I had a deal and you call me, you said there's quick money here, come and pick your 1M. Even if it's raining, my friend, rather than you sending that man on mobile money, I'd rather come and be hit by the rain and pick the 1M.
Sometimes it's also parking space and parking fees, most especially in the city center during the day. By the time you drive your car from New Vision, parking whatever, then you go to town. You're
By the time your car
small.
Has been clamped, then you already have issues with parking.
Then, yeah, but listen, what I'm saying is this, the parking space, you want to go to, let's say, Mukwano, but there's no parking. So you have to park up these
and then,
walk down. Walk down or get a bike down. Mm. So why don't I leave the car at New Vision
and
jump
then
on
get
a bike?
A border and get there. Well, probably, that's one of the, you know, things that's getting deserted online. Anyway, on a more
but if you don't have a car, it is also okay.
It's also allowed.
So you're not alone. You don't feel
even
bad.
Taruk is raising his
you
hand that he's also here.
Yes. So it's not a crime for you not owning a car. And it will also come.
Okay. So, New Vision has run a story about fake eggs. Now, this story has got people talking. Mm. A New Vision came out and ran a story. They say we got a tip from a lady who was mistreated by her employers and later dismissed. She gave us info that her ex-bosses were manufacturing eggs in Kawempe along Tula Road. That's part of the tweet. But, you know, they say that these Chinese investors were manufacturing fake eggs. And they put a picture there for you in the New Vision and online. And people have been talking about it. Now, what's interesting about the story is that UNBS comes up and calls this a fake story.
Says they were sweets.
Yeah, and says they were sweets.
But sweets in an egg.
Yeah, they are. Yeah. I mean, Chinese have mastered the art of producing some of the most interesting things.
But
I mean, they have
a sweet in an egg. Do you know how big that sweet is?
Range Rovers.
Unless you're saying that you.
Yeah, they are. In a sweet
I want to see those eggs. I want to eat.
Unless the sweet is inside.
Yeah, it's inside.
Yeah, so you crack the shell and then
you eat the sweet.
They are there.
Yes, but there's a tweet I've seen which also says that, yes, the sweets are there, but the fake eggs are also there.
They're also there, yes. Now, people have come out and say, guy, look. You can't just keep on defending stuff that, you know, you haven't investigated. Of course, UNBS came out. Yeah, they came out with a statement clearly saying that, you know, this is a fake story and it shouldn't be put out there, stuff like that. But Tracy Gwambe, one of, I think she works with the New Vision, she says, we can sit around and call it fake news all we want or consume
the real fake eggs.
One of the people formerly employed by the Chinese a company manufacturing fake eggs, which were discovered in Kampala recently, spoke out.
Now, she says it's our choice. Sit down and talk about it. Go eat the fake eggs.
But I
like the way she thinks.
And
on the other hand, I think we also need to I don't know. I'm just saying, did this journalist really see those fake eggs? Because this employee who was sacked can also decide to come up with a story.
Because he was sacked.
So I also need to talk, sit down with that journalist and say, what happened? What did you see? How are they manufactured?
Real fake?
I want to see that yolk that is fake. How does it look like? But manufactured from what? Plastic.
I don't know. I mean, I just want to understand.
Ivan called your Twitter and said,
I first heard about Chinese that had manufactured rice and imported it to Nigeria. Not that my country, Uganda,
not knowing
that. Not knowing that, yeah, in line with manufactured eggs. Why always Chinese with fake product? remember the story about why? Fake rice? Remember the story about tablets that had wires in between the tablet, you'd find a wire.
Which tablet? This
I saw that story as well. Yeah.
And then they were blaming it on Chinese in Nigeria. So, I mean, when you hear such, then you you can't be shocked. Uganda police is hunting for Chinese men. Of course, that's Grace Natawalo. The journalist who did the story insists the fake eggs exist. As an egg eater, stick to what the Ugandan supermarket sells, stick to Mwonge yellow yolk eggs. But you see, these Chinese products, then you crack it and pour it. But Chinese products are cheap. They're very, very, very cheap. So even if you say I'm going to stick to Ugandan shops and supermarkets, then I mean, these guys also want to make money, so they'll go buy the cheaper eggs and bring them and sell them highly to make a profit. So basically, you just have to have an egg supplier. Well, you know, this egg comes
I can
from
imagine
have
your
own hands. Let them give you the eggs. So that you're sure you're not eating fake things.
Before we do sign out, there's a couple of other interesting things I'm seeing right here. Talking about Mujisha Muntu.
Oh, that cartoon.
Ogu is my favorite cartoonist. And he did a Mujisha Muntu cartoon. Mujisha Muntu running away from FDC with bricks.
With the property.
Yeah,
with property.
Yeah.
To new formation.
To start his own new formation thing and Mugisha Muntu.
The pick is interesting. I like
and it. And save with malice towards none, with clarity for all, with firmness in the right, as God gives us to see that this guy is
the right. Let us strive on to finish.
Mugisha Muntu is poetic all the time.
Like, yeah, just like this.
Like, have you ever thought about how Mugisha Muntu quarrels? Like, if he gets into a fight, he probably
He looks like a very short tempered person, though.
I saw him
during his press conference, and when they were firing these questions, some of the questions that he didn't like, he had this aggressive kind of reply.
And he uses big words.
And then he'd give you this evil laughter.
This rampant, misogynistic.
You better work for the life outside that uniform. Like,
I will reject you from my party.
So I just want to see how he complains.
He complains like,
in his torment.
But this is such a such men who are like that, you find when they get home, the woman just tells them, what is that? What's he done?
And he says, don't.
And the guy is like, no, it's okay. And I am done.
There's a very interesting guy. Kyle Spencer is saying that the Uganda government plans to nationalize the country's internet infrastructure. The recently signed national broadband policy mandates
forced use
of government network infrastructure, centralized international gateways and government control of IXPs plus TLD.
Okay, are we going to be forced to use internet?
No. It's going to nationalize. It's going to be like a national hotel, Umeme. Yeah, like you pay very, very little fee to maintain.
But are we paying little fee for Umeme?
Well, I mean,
the government believes
yes.
A very beautiful the morning.
It's
raining. For
it's
us,
raining. Yeah? I saw pictures from somebody on Twitter. My friend of mine. He just posted pictures online, and I was like, yo. I mean,
pictures of around Bugolobi.
Yeah, Bugolobi and
plus gets really messy when it rains. Yeah. But anyway, we get to sign out here, and we do wish you the very best. Thank you very much for being such a lovely audience. I already see some winners of the t-shirts. That is very good. We have a couple of them to give out. So more questions will be coming. Just keep watching Urban Today and keep it ready on Urban Television.